is that we could meet this demand by the first closure of Indian Point if we just pushed ourselves on energy efficiency and renewables. So we don't need to sacrifice other communities to get more power. So, you know, Rick mentioned that the pipeline folks and the nuclear folks have been kind of pitted against each other because the powers that be really want this narrative that if we're closing Indian Point, then we need something else. And that means we need gas pipelines, we need gas power plants. That's not true. We don't need that. And that is why we're working together, because no community should be at risk from energy generation. So that's kind of the driest, boring part, but that is one of the problems. So now to the absurd. So I told you, here's Indian Point nuclear power plant. I told you there were existing pipelines that run under the river and then right through the Indian Point property, and then on through my community and across northern Westchester. But when Spectra Energy came through and said they wanted to expand the gas pipeline, Entergy was like, well, you're not expanding it on our property. So they needed to come up with a new route. So they went across the river south of here. It's a St. Patrick's Church. They came through Verplank and Buchanan. Here's my kids' elementary school. And here's the Peekskill MNR. This is my house, and we're just right up here. And they built this massive 42-inch high-pressure frack gas pipeline. And what is remarkable is that this little dot here says Buchanan South Substation. This is the substation that controls the power to Indian Point. The yellow is the what's called potential impact radius of the pipeline, meaning if the pipeline ruptures, what stuff is going to be leveled and catch on fire. So you can see that power supply for the plant is in that potential impact radius. And you can see then also the impact radius of the old pipelines running under the plant. And these impact radiuses are just a really simple kind of back of the envelope calculation that's used. In real life conditions, it's usually much, much greater areas that are impacted by the fire. So when Spectra proposed this, for lots of reasons, not only because now my house would be at risk, my kids' school would be at risk, but because Indian Point itself would be at risk, a lot of us got together and started fighting this infrastructure. But I do want to tell you a little bit about how we got to this point and what risks we're facing, because it shows how important it is that we watch out this. So on the left here is my mail sitting on my kitchen counter. And what you see is on this particular year, I got both the Indian Point emergency guide and the Spectra Energy Pipeline Rupture Guide on the same day in my mailbox. Because that's where I live. And I compared these two things, and I concluded that I should neither stay at home, nor should I leave my home. I should neither walk away nor start my car. I should not make a phone call. I should call the emergency number. I'm not clear exactly what I'm supposed to do, because these two documents don't agree with each other. So if something happens to Indian Point because of a pipeline rupture, really nobody knows what they're going to do. And how frequently do these pipeline ruptures happen? Well, basically in this country we have what's called a significant pipeline rupture more than 6 times per week. And significant means it does more than $50,000 worth of damage, or someone is injured or killed. So basically every single day of the year, pretty much, we have a pipeline rupture. And what you can see from this is basically a graph showing the number of pipeline incidences per 10,000 miles of pipeline, but based on the year that the pipelines were built. So the existing pipelines that are under Indian Point were built in the 50s and 60s, which means they have about 2 instances per 10,000 miles of pipeline. But if you look where the arrow is, see this really high bar? This is pipelines built since the 2010s. That means the new high-pressure fracked gas pipeline going under Indian Point. And you can see it's got really high. So this number, for those who can see, is 6.6 instances. So basically 3 times the rate of the old pipelines. And this is data from PHMSA, which stands for the Pipeline and Hazardous Materials Safety Administration. And they, when asked, like, why is this rate skyrocketing, they said, oh, well, you know, there's new technologies in use. And whenever you introduce new technologies, there's a learning curve. Okay, so this is the administration tasked with pipeline safety that are totally cool with this learning curve. So this is a genuine and real risk. And so what about Spectra's safety record? How often does that happen? Well, this is a picture from the Arkansas Times, and it's a picture of the Arkansas River looking like a hot tub. And it's those bubbles that are there are gas escaping from a pipeline under the river. And this is from the annals of, you cannot make this up, so you can go ahead and Google it. So Spectra Energy had this 24-inch pipeline running under the Arkansas River, and they considered it an auxiliary pipeline because they had put a new pipeline through, but they left this one in place. They closed off the valves, but it was still full of gas, and they just left it there. Then there was a lot of flooding, high waters on the Arkansas River, and someone, basically a tugboat captain, called the Coast Guard and said, you know, I arrived at my boat today and it's damaged and there's hunks of concrete on it and I don't know what happened. And so the Coast Guard shows up at the tugboat and they say, I think there's a gas pipeline near here. Maybe it's that. And so they called Spectra Energy and lo and behold, in the high waters, the Spectra's pipeline had ruptured. And someone took this picture of it and in the explosion, thankfully it didn't catch fire, but the explosion blew chunks of concrete onto this tugboat captain's boat and damaged his boat. Spectra had no idea it had happened. The Coast Guard called them, and that was how Spectra knew that their pipeline had blown up, a tugboat captain. And this plan to leave as an auxiliary pipeline is what is happening with the Algonquin pipeline segments that were replaced by the 42-inch pipeline. So less than a year later, in Pennsylvania, Spectra Energy again, they had a 30-inch pipeline. Their Texas Eastern pipeline rupture outside of Pittsburgh in the middle of farmland. And I don't know if you can tell from here, but this is a house. This red dot is where the pipeline was that blew up. So yellow is basically areas that were demolished, that blew up. And this red, big red circle is the area that caught fire and burned. And so there was a man sleeping. Thankfully, his wife and children had left. But it knocked down his house completely, and he was rescued, basically had his clothes burned off and was running down the street, and a neighbor thankfully stopped and got him. But siding melted off houses like a mile away from this rupture, and this fire burned for hours, and this man is still, like, his life will never go back to normal. He lost limbs, he was burned over much of his body. And this was the middle of nowhere, Pennsylvania, that this happened. This was a 30-inch pipeline. And so you can see, it left this debris field 800 feet wide. Mike, hold on a second. Is this going to alarm if I open it? Stop throwing snowballs.
I think we know who that
might be. No, sorry. It's not. So basically, this 800 feet was the debris field, this 1300 feet was what burned. So my husband is Andy with the computer, and to remind you now, so we're 800 feet and 1400 feet from a 30-inch pipeline. The existing pipelines are 26 and 30 inches running here, 42 inches running here. So if we overlay that debris field onto this pipeline that we have here near Indian Point. Here is, we put it here along this pipeline route. You can see this area that is the debris field. You can see this area that burns. Of particular concern to me is my kids' elementary school here and the ballpark and playground where they play after school. But if you notice, here is that power station I told you that controls all the power to the plant. And